originally defined the rank as the number of pivots in the REF. If a row is a linear combination of other rows, that means an equation, a row is an equation in the context of solving equations, can be obtained by algebraic manipulations of other equations, which means by doing row operations, which are like algebraic manipulations on equations, that row will get killed, meaning it will become a zero row and it'll get pushed down to the bottom of the REF of the augmented matrix. So every row that is not a zero row will have a pivot because there will be at least one element that is not zero. So there will be a pivot. So the number of pivots is also the number of rows that cannot be killed. That means it's the number of linearly independent rows. So just as a reminder, we have the three EROs here, swap init true rows, which we tried very hard not to use, but we had to use it in some cases. This multiply a row, scaling a row, we did not use. And then add a multiple of any row to another, which was the mainstay of Gaussian elimination, so that we could get rid of all the elements in one column. By get rid of, I mean make them zero. So all non-zero rows in REF will have pivots. That implies that the rank of a matrix is the number of linearly independent rows. If a row is a linear combination of other rows, Gaussian elimination will make it a zero row. And so this is the number of linearly independent rows in A. That is the rank. This is a better way of looking at it, or more sophisticated way of looking at it, because it has implications about the geometry of the spaces defined by the matrix A. So you can also say that is the number of linearly independent columns. The number of linearly independent rows, you can call it the row rank. And the number of linearly independent columns, you can call it the column rank. So there is a famous theorem, a foundational theorem in linear algebra, that says that the row rank is the same as a column rank. When I define row rank and column rank this way, it is not completely obvious why they have to be the same. But if you think of the rank as the number of pivots, then it's kind of obvious why the row rank and column rank are the same. So number of rows with pivots is the same as the number of columns with pivots. One thing we might want to keep in mind for our purposes in computer science and data science is that our data matrices tend to be tall, meaning more rows than columns, because you have measurements along a few features or variables, and you have more and more measurements coming in. More than that, this tall matrix, the columns tend to be linearly independent because they are real measurements. There's no reason why they will have any kind of linear dependency. The rank cannot be more than the total number of rows or columns. So let's take a look at a few properties of ranks. Some of them are actually useful in computer science. Some of them are more mathematical and interesting only in an academic way. So if I have two matrices, A and B, of the same size so that they can be added, rank of a sum is less than or equal to the sum of rank. So this can be extended to say that if you have a matrix of rank R, it can be written as a sum of R rank 1 matrices and no more. That statement also might sound insignificant, but it has some applications, especially when it comes to data compression. Suppose I have a matrix A that is in R 100 by 100. How many elements does it have? That is 10k. So if you need to store it, you will need 10k storage locations, memory. Now, suppose I know that this is a rank 1 matrix. The row rank is 1. What does that mean? So there's only one row out of the 100 here that is linearly independent. That means all other 99 rows are actually scalar multiples of this one row. So in effect, I have 100 elements in one row and 99 numbers. So that's the information in this matrix of 10k numbers. So that's all I need to store. So I need to store only 199. Let's just call it 200 numbers. That's a huge saving. That is data compression, really. If it is an image which has, let's say, four channels, and each channel is a table of numbers, and if you know for some reason that is rank 1, then that is a huge amount of saving in storing that. In other words, if you can find some way of saying that my 100 by 100 matrix, there are only 5 ranks that are significant, all other ranks are like noise, that basically means that you need to have only 5 rows, so that is 5 times 100. And some linear combination, some numbers that might be like 5 times 99 or something, 500 basically. So it's about 1000 numbers that you need if you know that the important part of the matrix, the principal components as it were, of the matrix are only 5. Then you need only 5 such matrices, and they can be stored in 1k as opposed to 10k storage locations. So that would be a compression algorithm. So this strange looking inequality here does have applications. Another one also that has significant applications in many places is this guy. Rank of A transpose A is the same as rank of A transpose, the same as the rank of A and the rank of A transpose. Rank of A and A transpose, they are the same, because the number of pivots is the same. the matrix or its transpose, and A transpose A. Okay, if you have a data matrix in R m by n, m being much larger than n, if I take A transpose, that is going to be a member of R n by m, and if I take A transpose A, that will be a member of R n by n, because this m and this m will cancel off, and what is left would be the number of columns, number of variables or number of columns. That is a small number compared to m, which is a number of rows. So it's a small matrix, and the rank of this matrix A is likely to be the number of columns, because it's coming from real measurements, and the numbers are going to be distinct and not linearly dependent. So the rank is going to be full rank. This rank also is going to be n, so it's a full rank matrix. On the other hand, if I take A transpose, that is going to be in R m by n, m being much larger than n. This is a huge matrix. Its rank also is n. So that means m being much bigger than n, this A transpose is a horribly rank deficient matrix. The rank deficiency is m minus n, which is huge. So there is no chance in hell that you will be able to invert this. It's a horribly singular matrix. But on the other hand, this is a much nicer matrix. This is called the gamma matrix. And this will turn out to be the covariance if you do some initial processing of the data. That matrix is quite significant in machine learning. So those things are all useful. Now there are other properties that the only zero rank matrix is actually the zero matrix. Zero rank, that is a strange concept. That basically says that the number of pivots is zero, which can happen if all rows are actually zero rows, then there is no leading non-zero element anywhere. So that way it is easy to understand. But we also defined the rank as a number of linearly independent rows. So the number of linearly independent rows also can be zero, which is quite interesting. If I have a matrix, how do you have number of linearly independent rows equal to zero? So that points to the specialness of the zero vector. Zero is actually a very interesting character in the world of numbers and also in the world of matrices. The zero matrix is a very interesting, or zero vector, I should say, is a very interesting kind of vector. If I have a zero vector, and if I take any other vector A, multiply by zero, of course you get a zero vector. Remember, scalar multiples of a vector will be on the same line as the vector. So zero is actually on the same line as any other vector. Let's call that collinearity parallel. So zero vector is actually parallel to any other vector. So that means zero is parallel to any vector you can find. Now, how do you define perpendicularity? If A dot B equal to zero, then that implies A is orthogonal to B, which is another word for perpendicularity. But we know that A dot zero is always zero because it's some product of the elements. A1 times 0 plus A2 times 0, etc. So this is 0. That means 0 is also perpendicular to any vector that you can find. So 0 is a very strange entity, parallel and perpendicular to everything else. One more thing is that suppose I have a square matrix A n by n is all zeros. The number of linearly independent rows here is not 1, it's actually 0. You can say, using the lingo of a set theory, the rank of this matrix is the number of linearly independent rows, which is the cardinality of the set of linearly independent rows. And if the set is actually just the zero vector, its cardinality, which means the number of elements in that set, is not 1, but actually 0. That is what that statement says. So another property, much like the summation property, the rank of a product is less than or equal to the product of the ranks. Another one is that if B is a full column rank matrix, full column rank, we'll call it a full rank also, then rank of AB is just the rank of A, which comes from this and the column picture of matrix multiplication. If B is a full row rank matrix, which is again something that you will call full rank, then rank of BA is the same as rank of A. That comes from the row picture of matrix multiplication. Okay, let's move on to shapes of matrices. I call a matrix tall if it has got more rows than columns. A is a member of R m by n, and m is larger than n, more rows than columns. If the columns are linearly independent, which will be the case in most data science applications, then we will call it a full column rank matrix. And we'll call it also a full rank matrix because the maximum rank it can have is the number of columns, and it does have it. So full column rank is the same as full rank. So most data matrices will have M much larger than N with full column rank. If, in this case, you think of the matrix as encoding a system of linear equations, then obviously you have too many equations and you will not be able to solve it. But you might still want to ask yourself what's the best possible solution. A wide matrix, which is the one with more columns than rows, if the rows are linearly independent, that would mean that it's a full row rank matrix. If it is a full row rank matrix, then Ax equal to B is a situation in which you have fewer equations than unknowns and you'll have an infinity of solutions. Now, let's talk about full rank once more. For a square matrix, full rank means the rank is the same as the number of rows and the number of columns. And if it is not full rank, then the rank deficiency is the number of rows or number of columns minus the rank. And if it is a tor matrix, if all the columns are independent, then it's got full column rank. And otherwise, the rank deficiency is the number of columns minus the actual rank that it does have. A wide matrix, on the other hand, if all the rows are independent, then it's a full row rank matrix. Otherwise, it's got a rank deficiency, which is the same as the number of rows minus the rank that it has. Full column or full row rank, we will call it full rank.